Good evening, friends. Welcome to another session of Inspiring Conversations. It's always lovely to have you all at these sessions. Let me introduce to you our chief guest for the evening, Ms. Amisha Vora. Amisha Vora is a joint managing director and key shareholder at Prabhudas Lilladher Group, having more than 30 years of rich experience in Indian equities, and she is a well-respected opinion maker in the equity markets. She is one of the leading women entrepreneurs in India today, and is regularly featured on leading business channels like CNBC and ET Now for her views and insights on stocks and industries. Amisha Vora is a commerce graduate from the Narsee Monjee College, Mumbai, and has always been a gold medalist throughout her school and college education. She did her chartered accountancy from the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and was one of the youngest chartered accountants by the age of 21. Amisha Vora joined Prabhudas Lilladher in 2000 and she was the Vice President of FII Sales. Her diligence and innovative ideas like theme conferences helped her company to gain more corporate access. She was promoted to the Head of Institutional Sales and then as Director of Institutional Sales in the subsequent year. She streamlined the business in the international territories and executed strategies to increase the number of clients and built strong relationships with clients to ensure steady business. Along with her partners, she improved corporate access, fundamental research and institutional sales as evidenced by creditable rankings in Asia Money and rapid growth of the institutional business, which grew 36 times in just 6 years. Her innovative conferences on banking and power equipments led to a 4 to 5 times appreciation in those stocks. In 2005, Amisha proposed that her company enters the corporate advisory business along with a new company, PL Advisory Services Private Limited, in which she held equity stake and was appointed as the director. Under her, the corporate advisory business helped corporates raise over $1 billion during 2005-2008. In 2007, she became a joint managing director in the holding company of the group and for PL Capital Markets Private Limited, when PL acquired an investment banking license. Amisha also spearheaded the foray of Prabhudas Lilladher into the NBFC business. She ultimately took charge of the group's retail broking in 2012. For all the initiatives that she has done and for all the achievements that she has achieved, she has also been awarded with numerous awards like the Best Salesperson of the Year by Asia Money for 3 consecutive years. She is also one of the most 10 powerful women as a rising star by the India Business Today. She was also conferred with the award for Outstanding Contribution to Equity Markets by the Z Business Market Analysis Award. Her social contribution has been also a very tremendous initiative. Amisha is a long-time supporter of Happy Home Orphanage in Mumbai and a regular contributor to Upashrayas, which are Jain spiritual centers across the country. Amisha is a strong believer in women's right to determining their own careers. She always says, girls have the right to decide their career path rather than letting their marital lives decide it. Amisha's parents and her husband have been staunchly supportive of her ambitions. According to her, in whatever field one chooses to work, passion and dedication are of paramount importance. Friends, I bring to you Amisha Vora. So behind every successful woman, there is a man. That's her husband. We are very tired of listening to behind every successful man, there is a woman. So here there is a very successful lady. The cooperation that she got from her parents and from her husband has taken her to great heights. She's an international figure, always talking about the stock and the market conditions of the country. So we are very lucky to have her here today evening. So can we start? Friends, we all use Colgate? Okay, most of us. Her father used Colgate for a different reason. He invested in the stock of Colgate, and this is a true story. They are 4 sisters. For every marriage, the father sold a part of those Colgate shares and got them married. So every time you do a Colgate, now remember this story. So
So that is all about investments, and what better to learn from than from a Gujarati or a Marwadi, that investing in stocks and shares is always going to give you glorious days ahead. So Amisha, you started as an employee and today you are a very successful entrepreneur and you are partners with one of the most reputed organization, Prabhudas Lilladher, which is one of the oldest organizations since 1944, 3 years before the independence, and you are today a partner with them. How do you feel and how was the journey?
I feel good, but just on the way, not achieved or not arrived.
So you believe that travel is a continuous journey, right?
Travel is a continuous journey and a long, long way to go. And just one more thing I'll add, because you're talking about my organization, that is Prabhudas Lilladher. For the year 15-16, we were chosen as one of the top 50 brands from Asia.
Wow, 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 fantastic, fantastic, fantastic. And this I would like to say, that she is one of the top 10 women entrepreneurs in India, which is such a large country. Of course, there are powerful women, but she also is one of them, and we feel proud about that, that we know one such proud, powerful lady in the country. So Amisha, you must have started very young into your job career. As soon as you became a chartered accountant, you're already on your way. So this is a very male-dominated activity. Generally, I think 90% of the people involved in the stock markets are males. How did you feel entering into this line of business? Was it accidental or was it a conscious decision?
So entering the equity markets was definitely not my first choice. When I finished my chartered accountancy, my dream was to become a consultant on corporate advisory, merger acquisition, etc. But of course, my father and the whole family being into investments and markets, I was shown this as the door to enter the world of my ambition. And as I entered, I realized that this is the life which anybody would envy to have, because every day something is changing. You are so involved, and how much you get to know about what is happening in the world, I fall in love with the line I chose.
There. And you chose it, and you have expanded today to be an entrepreneur in the industry. How are you different in the industry compared to the others? As an entrepreneur, what are the decisions that you took differently which gave you quick success in this business?
I think the only thing which I always kept in mind is, what is it that is bothering my client? So initially when I started my journey, my clients were all the institutional clients, whether sitting in US or Asia or within India, and which development in their stock which is bothering them, they want an answer for, whether the management is doing right, whether the sector is doing right. And to get that answer, I was trying to find out ways, whether through channel checks, whether through conferences, whether through conversation with the management or somebody who's advising management. That is what was appreciated, and client always loved it. And that's how I got a very good beginning.
Whenever a foreign investor comes into the country, large foreign institutions which invest in developing countries like India, what is the confidence that you give them? Because probably like how you want an advertising agency and you get a pitch from 10 people, they also would be doing similar things for financial investments. So how do you convince them then? What is the differentiating points that you convince them on?
One is that, you know, when we have the largest economy in terms of, second largest maybe in terms of population, and the youngest economy, there can't be growth other than in India.
Right.
So that is the key thing which will continue in favor of India for a long, long time to come. So we always do a two-way, mindshare journey of theirs. One, we make them meet some of the policymakers to make them get that confidence that it is a very stable country. It's not what you keep hearing in media. It's much beyond that. And of course, then we take them micro down to which are the sectors where spending is happening and which are out of that the selective companies which are really geared up to gain out of this growth which is happening in the country, and which is what as a combination really works well.
So your competition also would be doing this. Like suppose if there is an XYZ institution
Absolutely. Wanting
to invest $200 million in the country, they will go to 10 companies. One would be Prabhudas Lilladher.
Exactly.
At that point of time, what is your qualifying point?
So I think it's always the insights which you get which differentiates you. So my competition typically is not domestic broking houses. My competition is all global broking houses, and they have their linkages all over. For example, a Morgan Stanley or a CSFB. So the clients have both the access, and then to create an insight is what clearly differentiates. So we have specialized in mid caps.
So this industry typically works on research on how you can be better and better in knowledge on which sectors to invest in. And for its research, you need a very good, strong talent pool. Absolutely. What are your methods of research when vis-a-vis the other people in the industry? What is your strength of research?
I think the industry at the moment is structured in terms of sectorial research, which is what is a must for most of us as the broking houses. The differentiating factor that we try and bring for institutional investors is in terms of the focus being also equally and more on mid-caps. Because generally in a growing economy, if you catch some of the organizations young, then you make multifold money. So we have kept our focus as mid-caps.
So for the knowledge of everybody, if you can just in one paragraph explain
what is
mid-cap and a large cap.
Correct. So any stock which is under Nifty 50, that is the index, is typically a large cap. And any stock which falls out of that in terms of market cap, where the last thing stops and is about 2,500 crores, is typically we call them as mid caps, which is where they then gain much larger growth over the next some time, say 10 years or 5 years, as compared to the large caps, which is equally and big and dominating already.
What has been more successful for you, investments in mid caps or large caps, in terms of percentages in the last 10 years?
So it is of course mid caps, but at the same time, when the tides turn and you know, there was like the 2008 to 2010 period when the money was going out of the markets, then mid caps also underperform and they suffer a lot because people have risk off. They want less risk, so they will go to liquid and more large corporations. Then the mid caps suffer a lot. But typically on a longish period, it is mid caps who do much, give much better return.
So India as a country has seen two large scams. One is Harshad Mehta, and in the 90s, in the early 90s, and second was Ketan Parekh. Whenever this scam takes place, how does investment companies sustain? Because when a scam takes place, the investigation, the impact, the after impact, it takes up a couple of years. During that period, everybody is scared of the stock market. Investments go down, foreign investors run away. During such times, when you operate with fixed costs and resources, how do you balance your existence and survival?
You're very right. You know, actually, my seeds of being an entrepreneur, without me realizing, were sown when the Ketan Parekh crisis happened. And the fixed cost of my company was typically very high. I was leading the whole institutional team, but the business had collapsed to 10% of what it used to be.
Wow.
And then we decided that, you know, instead of parting the team, why not we cooperate with the company? And we all took voluntary cut. I being the highest paid, I took the largest cut and allowed everybody else to decide what cut they are ready to take. And we all stayed together. And that gave us a tremendous chance to bounce back, because within just 9 months, the scene had changed again. And that's what happens in the market. And as what, you know, you had also read out, in just next 4 to 5 years, the business went up 36-40-fold.
So in I think 6 years' time. Yes. In just 6 years' time. So I think this calamity was a big opportunity for you.
Exactly.
This calamity was biggest opportunity for you.
Exactly. And that was a very voluntary and intuitive decision by me, because I thought that it was not told to me by management that this is how we handle. I only thought that, you know, we are good. We are a good team. We are a good brand. And we are doing a good job. Why not to sustain for a while and allow this thing to tide over? And that's where somewhere the management got confidence that I can see both the sides
more clearly. Fantastic. You have started a lot of new initiatives for the organization. Like Prabhudas Lilladher was the first broking firm to get a license from the Bombay Stock Exchange or National Stock Exchange?
Way back.
You are the first broking firm. And post that, today when you talk about Prabhudas Lilladher, you are into multiple activities. You are into institutional investments, you are into retail investments, you are into NBFC as well. Were you responsible for the majority of the diversifications that happened in the last 10, 12 years?
Yeah, because most of these were pretty interlinked activities. So when typically you want to recommend a stock, you know what the management is trying to do and what they need in the process of growing their business. So do they need some equity or debt infusion in the process? So knowing that is, you try to help corporate also, positioning them well across the institutional investor, helping them raise money. So the corporate advisory or investment banking business is a corollary to this business.
How do you do the introspection of the research that your team does? And who takes the final decision on what needs to be done forward?
So of course, now the organization is pretty huge. It's about 350 people team. So a lot of things are delegated, and there is a head of research, there are sectorial analysts, there are associates. But yes, in terms of now screening where we focus in terms of sector and stocks, it still comes to a core committee where I am one of the part, but a lot of things are delegated.
So what are your core strengths as a leader in the organization? What are your core strengths?
I think over the years, as what I keep hearing from my team members, one of the core thing is that I have the skill which is required for the business, which is analyzing the business, understanding the business, and then positioning. Because, you know, while most of us work for 8 hours, 10 hours, and earn money, my typical job or my company's typical job is that your money work for you. And that has to be done at a very careful and measured way, not with a lot of aggression, and temper the aggression in investors. So that skill that we have, and then the second thing which probably I hear from a lot of my colleagues is that I don't keep my work for tomorrow. I always finish my today's work today.
Fantastic, fantastic. That I think is a very good point to do, because as entrepreneurs, we are very familiar with a word called procrastination. We always try to do today's work day to day after tomorrow. So you try to do it the same day. I'm sure that is one of the qualifying points. Being a research-based business model, you must be having a great talent pool with you. They must be engineers and chartered accountants and IIM Ahmedabad and the works, the IITNs and the works. How do you do performance management with them?
So, you know, the whole process, it's not only in research, but research has to be sold. That means the client has to be convinced as to what you believe in. So sales is also equally important. And I have now two sets of clients. I have clients, institutional clients. I have large HNI and retail clients. We have about 80,000 retail clients across India. And I have corporates also as my client, whom I have to educate, whether they are upcoming or pretty large, that the biggest currency that you hold is your own company shares. You don't undermine that. And to really unlock the wealth, what you really need is transparency.
So Amisha, real estate affects the stock market affects the gold market affects the dollar market. How do you keep eyes on all these activities together at the same time? Because all are interconnected.
That is absolutely true. But I think that the next 10 years phase in India is a phase very different from past 50 years phase, when everybody was hoarding money rather than they had desire to grow their money. So while you were generating...
Now nobody has money to hoard. Demonetization.
Exactly. So the compulsorily a lot of
money... Are there any news that they are going to tap gold also?
But even if they do, gold is a dead investment. You know, we want to hoard. We don't want to grow. That's why we keep latching onto it. That mentality is bound to change, trust me. Out of a country of 120 crores, there are still only 4 crore people who have either their mutual fund folios or their demat account. And I think over next 5 to 10 years, I mean not less than 5, but between 5 and 10 years, this will grow multifold. US had a period when they grew 25 folds in a period of 15 years, I think we will do it in a much shorter time because of the technology disruption.
Fantastic, fantastic. What I want to ask was, 30 years back, or say 25 years back, when we were also in school and all that, we used to always hear that our population is the biggest curse, it's the biggest burden of the country. Suddenly it has become a gold mine, and this population has become a very creative customer for the rest of the world. How will this encashment happen for improving the economy of the country?
So I think, you know, I somehow believe that things could not have been more fortunate, because after demographically the most young country, getting the most correct leadership, it's always the leadership which makes a difference. And leadership is so focused to harness what is our key wealth, that is our youth, and you know, whatever the new government's initiatives are to A, reduce corruption, to direct subsidies, at the same time allow industry to one by one come out of the problems which they are facing through either Chinese competition or XYZ, so many things, that now is the time for India.
There are so many factors which affect the stock market. If it rains, it affects. If it doesn't rain, it affects. If there are elections, it affects. If India wins the World Cup, it affects. If we lose the World Cup, it affects. There are so many variable factors. In this circus, where do you find your focus? How do you manage so many factors which keep affecting the industry?
So, you know, we need to make our fundas clear. A market or stock market is liquid. Whether we want to focus on the liquidity and make it our enemy, which that means we can't invest and stay put and come out because of so many volatility which it creates, or we want to make it our friend and
keep investing and stay invested.
Exactly, because see, basically there is two different things. Either you are trading or you are investing. When you are investing, for example, let me tell you, we came out with about 3 years back a stock idea called Britannia. So why did we like Britannia? We like Britannia because we understood that they have majority market share only in the southern part of India, and they want to put up over say next 5-7 years another 3 lakh distribution centers across north and middle of India. So their product was ready. They were increasing their distribution. Whether they increase it in the same pace or slightly less, they were supposed to grow pretty well. So when you make your investment assumption on some such calculated bet, then you have to see that unfolding rather than thinking that, oh, somebody is selling, so let me also sell and come out, I will get it cheaper, then you're going to miss out on the big run.
So there are two methods how foreign investors enter India. One is they want to work directly, which is through foreign direct investments in sectors like real estate or automobile, like a Mercedes coming in and a BMW coming in. And they want to tap the market directly by having Indians as their customers. The second method is investors send only their money. They don't want to do business in India. They send their money and they want experts like y'all to get their money invested in the right companies so that they can make money. Both the ways, India has become a very lucrative market to the foreigners. Do you think in the coming years, the speed of them coming in is going to multiply, and why? Because Donald Trump is going to do a lot of stuff which will restrict Americans going out and American funds going out. So what do you predict in this situation?
See, some of the key macro stability factors, as we call it, which is very important as to where is our inflation going, how is our interest rates in India, because it's inflation and interest rates that basically decide the spending capacity of people at large. And if people spend, companies invest to supply them things. So with the very clear focus on keeping fiscal deficit, that is, as a country, spending more than that we get as taxes, that focus is now very clear of this government, which is demonstrated. So India is a very stable country. Having said that, last 3 to 4 years was a term that we call it as global markets versus emerging markets. Emerging markets are clubbed as India, China, Russia, Brazil, so on and so forth. Now the trend is these economies, emerging economies, are bouncing back. So we think that this trend with little ups and downs, but is going to be in favor of emerging markets. And India, being a stable country, will continue to receive a much better flow from FIIs. But the key change factor is that the India has started receiving a lot of domestic flows, and that is also going to give a much bigger pull to the equity prices.
And even the government is encouraging investment in various sectors, and Make in India is a great initiative by the current government, which is making a lot of change in the industry. So how will impact internationally, impact India? Because there is a lot of fear in the industry which says that the biggest investors in any country which has grown has always been the American investors. That is the general understanding. I might be wrong. And if the biggest deterrent in US itself as a country is the rate of taxation is very, very high. And you can't hide your money in US. Every rupees, every dollar is tracked. Now suppose if the taxes get dropped from 30 or 40% to 15%, then US becomes a very great investment destination. So Americans might not invest in the other developing countries. In such a scenario, what happens to developing countries like India?
No, but one of the core thing is American penetration of most of the things is so high as compared to India's penetration. By penetration meaning 60% of people in India use, say, toothpaste or toothbrush, but only 10% as compared to world standards, we use, say, plastic, that means whatever, chair, door, or we use paints. So the way to go is very, very long for
us. So it won't impact as much. It won't impact as much.
Our growth will definitely come. Of course, they will grow better is always good for us, because most of the countries grow when the global growth is much better, because you export and that gives you that additional fillip to get money in and supports your domestic economy.
Fantastic. As a business leader, as an entrepreneur, you must have taken a lot of initiatives. Which is the initiative which has been the most successful, and which is an initiative which you discouraged later on? And why?
When I took over a retail business, or started looking into PL's retail business, I started meeting a lot of our partners. We have about 400 partners across India. And I realized that most of them never knew which is the best stock that we recommended and where were we making money for our investors. And that's the time I thought that, and most of the investors when I met, I realized that none of them probably know that it's not knowing the right stock, but putting the right money into that stock and holding it for right period of time makes the money for you. That there is a difference. And to achieve that goal, the new mantra which I have initiated is that I'm not going to rate my team. Typically in the industry, you rate by team. Have you done 3 times your salary? Have you done 5 times your salary? Have you done 8 times your salary? I have said how many percentage of your clients are making money is how I'm going to rate you.
Fantastic, fantastic, fantastic. When you talk about the new trends coming up, technology is driving it to a great extent. I think you have done some technological changes also in the industry. If you can speak something about that and how it was beneficial and how it was different from the industry.
So I think, you know what, a very simple logic I tried to put in place. It's early days. But I said that if people are coming to Prabhudas Lilladher, they are coming for Prabhudas Lilladher research, and it's our duty to make sure that they are successful in their wealth creation journey. So we created a strategy whereby we call it fundamental research, technical research, and other research. We have allocated money into a particular proportion, and we call the product Invest Active, which means that all the stocks that you're invested in, my research team is 24/7 monitoring it and the required changes they are doing. That particular product has outperformed market in last 3 years by 85%.
Wow.
And it's all in all very known stocks. It's not in any unknown stock which we don't know where it is going, why it is going, but with a very logical thing the research tracks. And that's my key goal going forward also, that to as many people who are with a lot of lure entering markets, who are not disciplined, who really doesn't know that how to make money and get lost into that volatility of the market, I want to introduce them with this money making or wealth generating product.
So people like your organization and you are basically influencers in the society because you lead the industry from the front. So you people are influencers. When a Shah Rukh Khan says, I love Santro, Santro sales go up, stock market prices go up, all that happens. I'm sure Prabhudas Lilladher does it. Other people also would be doing it. When you talk about a particular sector, the fortunes of that sector change. So how many times do you get induced to do so? And how many times do you really do it because you see the sector growth?
We don't get induced to do so because that doesn't help us in long term.
What and happens
the business
if
is
majority
all about
of your
being in long term?
When you've got a lot of investments done in a particular sector, but it is not doing as well as you anticipated it to do. Like for example, I'm selling four products. One product is selling well, the other product is not selling well. I'll start doing more advertising and marketing for the other one. So do you have to do that for improving sectors? Improving the image of the sector so that the prices again go up?
No, but market follows a particular rhythm. I'm sure there are different participants in market and their jobs are different. You know, market has one part which we call it as fundamental. The other part is demand supply. So some people specialize in working on demand supply of a stock, but we don't specialize in that. So our core call always comes from the fact that maybe in medium term, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, what are the key factors and what is the kind of opportunity which is there? And we try and harness that. Of course, in our judgment, we can go wrong or management can go wrong in delivering and trading that path of growth which is there. Both has happened to us.
According to you, at the position that we are at, India as a country, what are the four top sectors that need to be looked at from your personal opinion?
I think...
Why?
I think the entire focus should be on domestic consumption, as we call it, as we are one of the biggest markets. The second important thing is with GST coming in, there will be so much of level playing field between organized and unorganized that the undue competition will keep coming down. And because of which, wherever there is large unorganized market, they will become organized. So a lot of... companies within these sectors of home improvement where there are large unorganized markets are the place that we are liking.
What is your learning edge as an entrepreneur? What is your learning edge? How do you learn? How do you keep yourself updated?
So there are two ways. Earlier, of course, it used to be reading, whether reading on companies, stocks and sectors. But in last 3 to 5 years, it's reading about people, their motivation, how to keep people. How to make them feel good about and keep them engaged is the key thing that I keep learning about. Technology, of course, you can never, ignore because that's going to be the biggest disruptor and biggest opportunity. So you have to update yourself always on that.
So you keep investing in innovation so that you can keep your clients happy. You can keep your team on the proper line that they need to perform. Every day should be better than the previous day. You keep investing in innovation.
You have to keep investing in innovation, both in terms of technology, both in terms, also in terms of training your teams.
What is your best HR policy?
That's a very good question. If I only have to rate myself and say what is my best HR policy, is not a quite a
What do
right
you think
thing.
Has to be your best HR policy for your team, which they appreciate?
My dream is to make each of my team member part of my equity. And make them connected. And of course, the key...
ESOPs.
ESOPs is a must. But the key HR policy, if you ask me, is freedom of work from wherever you want and whenever you want.
And how do you monitor that?
The team has to be that engaged.
And how do you monitor that?
No, if the team is really engaged, it doesn't matter. For me, it never mattered whether I was at home, I was traveling. I used to decide, tomorrow at 7 o'clock, I want to reach at Singapore. I'll start in the night. So I know what has worked. It's then engaged team which works.
So you make sure that they're engaged with their profiles all the time, with their commitments, with their responsibilities all the time.
You have to motivate that they should feel they
want
to work.
How often do you interact with your core team? And what is the agenda on that meeting? How often do you meet?
So the defined reviews are generally once in a quarter, and my way of improvised way, I would say, of talking to them is asking them, what have they done good? Where do they think they can improve? And what do they want to do next? And how can I help them?
Fantastic, fantastic. So friends, now the house is open for questions. You can get started.
As we all saw, Rajesh remembering names of so many people. Similarly, I also met Dhiren Bhai. Dhiren Bhai is
one of the partners.
And I told him that I am Arvind Hirlekar. He said, yes, I know you. And I was shocked. My wife Medha worked for your company 30 years back. And he said, you are Medha's husband. So he knew me, he knew my wife's name also. Do you also have some such quality of remembering names or something else?
I remember numbers. Any balance sheet which has gone through my eyes, I never forget.
Superb, superb, superb. Yes. Arvind, he must be remembering you because you took away one of their staff.
Okay, recently, recently Modi has said that, you know, hard work has overtaken Harvard. So how true it is that for you? And when you select your team members, you know, it is people talk about the talent pool, but it is their drive that takes you ahead. So how do you, you know, take them on your team?
So I think the biggest thing I look for while hiring is the energy that they have and the kind of initiative they have, you know, desire to take. Of course, a lot of things can be acquired. You can help people to, you know, improve their skills, but you basically need that drive. So I look at the energy in the people.
Fantastic. Next question.
We are saying that by GST, there will be a level playing field between big players and small players. But today also there is an article in Economic Times, and I personally feel, because as a chartered accountant, when I am seeing my clients, the level playing field will be more in the favor of big organized sector, more. And this, our idea of developing own entrepreneurs, I feel it may go down and everybody may have to go for job only. If that things happens, so because they won't be able to fight with the competition because of money, manpower, HR problem, everything. That small people may not be able to fight with the big players. And when they are growing at a lower level, from when you are at 10 lakhs turnover and you want to go to 10 crore, at that time, in that in between period, there will be a very big gap and very big problems.
So I agree with you that when the competitive advantage was only evasion of tax, I'm sure there is going to be pain, and pain will be felt by all of us when a large portion of traders or anybody else would be feeling this pain. But that's still not the way to go. A lot of people will come to terms, I believe, and they will increase their, you know, they will find their edge. They say now everybody has to be ready to go through 5 changes in their career. We are just telling that everybody will get chance to find their USP. And it's not going to be that impossible. There will be a period of adjustment for sure.
One small question is about, you are a merchant banker, you are a stockbroker, you are helping companies to list. Any plan to list your own company? Question number one. Two questions, Rajesh, if you
allow. If she answers that in the affirmative, we'll start putting applications here only. Director's quota.
Yeah. And second one was connected to his question. These days, SME exchange is doing good. But we could not see PL active on SME platform. Any plans on that? Thank you.
Even on SME exchange, there are certain issues which we help them market, like Tejo Engineering and couple of more. Yeah. But we did it, not take it actively, because there was some market making rule where, you know, people needed to do little thing which is non-compliant, and we don't do much of the things which is crossing that compliance limit. But we supported the marketing where we thought that the stocks were really good. And the first thing which you asked, of course, we are open and willing, and there is some time frame.
But it'll be coming, right? So this interaction will help us.
What is your philosophy? Like Ramdev Agarwal is following QGLP. So what is your philosophy, number one? And who are your role model? Like Benjamin, Warren Buffett, or Charlie Munger? So just your take on that.
You know, even when in school, when I used to write essays, I never used to say so-and-so has quoted this, so-and-so has quoted this. For a change, that's not my style, that I have some role model. But with whatever little learning that I have done over the period, yeah, that's my style. But I think I always try and focus on what is the kind of opportunity which is there while identifying stock and what kind of growth can come. Because the key belief is market looks at future. So of course you need to check the hygiene factor, as we call, in terms of corporate governance and quality, etc., etc., and some of the return ratios. But the key thing which I always base my decision is on the growth which is likely to happen.
Now at the stage that you are, you have a lot of money with you and you're investing it for your clients also. There might be, how much of your decision is based on research and how much is on the feel or the gut feel? And if different partners have different opinions as to this money should go here, how do you resolve the deadlock between yourselves?
Correct. That's a very, very good question. And I don't know how at this age you understand these questions. It's really creditable.
He's into company formation as a business model.
So, you know, as you grow in your journey of your career, that is where you don't realize, but you invest a lot of time in trying to get consensus. In partners or board, you have to get consensus. At the same time, when you talk about teams, you have to try and make them feel the same dream that you're having for your company and invest time in making them feel that dream. So both the times are invested, and I'm sure I still do a lot of intuitive and investments. And when I say intuitive meaning, typically when I see that the things have bottomed out and I don't mind staying put in that investments for a longer time, I definitely do my personal investments. But for clients, I still allow only the investments which my analyst does.
So do you have situations where you use veto power when there is too much of conflicting ideas?
So at times, yes, you have to use it.
yes.
Yeah. PL has grown 50 times in the last decade due to the diversification which you have actually leaded. Now, to take another manifold jump in the next decade, do you feel foraying into pure banking and insurance is inevitable?
I think that is a very good opportunity, but I don't think as a group we are geared to be there at this point of time. We would still like to be in the circumference of money management and go on to the journey of different kinds of instrument for investments, in and around investments.
Yeah, Manjuna.
Amisha, firstly, congratulations on taking your journey in the stock market, making a firm so so reputed and with a good name and making such a big institution. So congratulations for
Thank
that.
Thank you so much.
I have been on the other side for about 30 years on the buy side, working for local mutual funds, foreign investors, and also hedge funds. What I found on the research side has been there is far too much consensus on the research side. To date, I find very little research from Indian firms or even foreign broking firms coming out with a sell report on any company. That's because most of them say that the moment they put that out, the management access goes. So there is a very insidious relationship between the... So I've seen many firms initiate coverage on a stock and after 1 year drop the coverage. And even now, for instance, when I personally research the companies, even the best managed companies, there is a price at which you buy and beyond that, no. Most of the best managed companies are trading 30, 40 times future earnings. I haven't found one single report saying that this is a time to hold your horses, stay out, be more disciplined, and wait for the right time. I know you can't perfectly time the market, but what is your call on that type of thing? Because I don't find any contrarian call in the market. Very few take the contrarian call and stick to that.
I agree to you. There are both the sides of the coin. One is, of course, on some of the large or mid-large corporates, when you take a very aggressive sell call, it impacts not official relationship, but yes, there is an impact of that. There is no doubt about it. But there are ways to, downplay that particular stock. For example, we have about 150 or 160 stocks under coverage. So what we bring as top picks, which is what is our top 20 stocks, which is where our focus has been, and then what are the next 20 stocks. So all those which are A, under coverage but not being focused, is any which way getting little sidelined, number one. Number two, you know, valuation is looking little stretched, no doubt about it. But till the time you find some convincing evidence of the whole trend changing, this same call we could have taken a year before and we could have proved totally wrong. So there is not so much froth that you come out boldly and say this is time not to invest or get onto cash. There would be some corrections, but in our wisdom, we are not thinking this is the time to get onto big time cash.
I think the batteries, yeah.
They have very funny terms, like they have a biased call on a stock, and after 6 months, if it goes up, or for some reason they have underweight or downgrade to neutral. I don't know what those terms mean, because as an investor for the long term, these terms have really no meaning at all. I mean, these things I think the Indian industry needs to get away from, because this is just tomfoolery actually.
But I think, you know, globally also a lot of funds chase index performance. A huge money is chasing index performance. So when you are chasing an index performance, even if you feel that for some time, you know, technology is no more a rising sun industry, rising star industry, you still keep little weight on that. But then you call it underweight, that you keep little money, not a lot of money.
Yeah, Hema, the last question.
Okay, tell us a secret how you manage your personal and professional life, because we women are usually stuck because of our family life. How do you sustain the success, the position you are in today?
I'm sure it's not easy.
Yes, but that's what I want to know.
Yeah. At the same time, so I wanted to always say in the beginning that it is not one man who's behind a successful woman. There are four men behind a successful woman. My husband, my father, my husband, my son, and my partner. My son has also played a equally and very good role in seeing her mom, his mom rather, not being present on his sports day at times, on his annual day at times, and still appreciating what I am doing. Maybe I would have invested that time in making him understand why it is important. But at the same time, when you want to balance between your personal life and professional life, I think to some extent your social life gets totally sacrificed. And that is what you should be ready for.
So thank you. That was excellent. And we come to the end of a very interesting session. Thank you, Amisha. That was awesome.